A very warm welcome to everyone. We'll just wait for about a minute or so that everybody starts joining. So I guess everybody can start joining we will begin now. I'm Toril from Pratham. I'm part of the research and innovations team at the skilling and entrepreneurship arm of Pratham. And I have with me my colleague Medha and Neeraj, who work in the education team, the education vertical of Pratham. And we're very happy to be co-hosting this session with Nudge on a very, very crucial topic, which is building resilience inside out, supporting our own teams during a crisis. So the first section, we will share insights from our interaction with 20 plus organizations we interviewed around sometime in June. And it will basically focus on the key policy pivots which organizations undertook to support their own teams during the pandemic. And this will be followed by a panel discussion where we will delve deeper into each of these topics and exchange learnings from the leaders themselves. For the panel today, we will be joined by experts from JPAL, Acumen India, Pradhan, and Pratham. We aim to start the panel discussion at around 4:30 and then do a quick Q&A for about 15 minutes from 5:15 onwards. I will request everyone to post their questions at the Q&A section. And you know, feel free to drop in questions as and when they come, whether it's about the report or anything else you would like to know specifically for your own organization. And we'll be happy to address them at the end of the panel discussion. And now I'll hand over to my colleague Medha to take us through the study that we did in June. Over to you, Medha.
Thanks, Toril, and hi, everyone who's joined in. Toril's already mentioned the flow of events that we have. As she mentioned, the last part is for questions, so please keep them coming. The study taught us that we have less answers that we've received and more questions. So the focus of this entire part is on the panel and hearing from everybody about their experiences. I also quickly want to share with everybody, I think you may have seen it, but when Toril called everybody experts, everybody looked very uncomfortably, because this is a group that likes to be fairly candid about what our experiences have been. And it is a group that I think has shared with me quite keenly that they're keen on sharing what we don't know and the challenges as much as what we've learned and what we know. So with that, I'll quickly begin. The findings that we're sharing right now are a very small part of a much larger sort of activity that we did. And the idea was to do two parts, to understand what organizations are doing, A, for their own teams to support them during the pandemic, and B, to see what organizations are doing for the communities that they work in to support communities through programmatic pivots during the pandemic. So for the scope of this conversation, we are restricting ourselves to what we did for our own teams. And the reason is that our teams are often at the front line of change, but not always, as we've seen in the pandemic, the first to receive support when required. And so our experiences was that we were trying to do as much as we can for our teams and always felt like we aren't doing enough. So we started reaching out to other organizations to see how they're supporting, what we can learn from other organizations, and where can we all collaborate to sort of strengthen the support that field teams and nonprofits and civil society can receive. So to quickly jump in to the next slide. Yeah. So as Toril mentioned, we spoke to some organizations. The data on the slide gives you a part of the picture, but we also did detailed deep dive video interviews with founders and chief executives of most of these organizations to understand the findings. So our questions were broadly focused on a couple of themes. The first one you see is around direct health support. The second was around mental health support. Third is around vaccination support. And fourth is around bereavement support when needed. So to quickly jump into what we saw in direct health support, This is the conversation we had with about 23 organizations and with a focus on teams that are fairly dispersed on the field. As the numbers tell us, a lot of organizations relied on private insurance. We saw that a lot of organizations preemptively, when the pandemic started, either in wave one or wave two, the ones that insurances tried to seek private insurance players, the organizations that did have private insurance increased the premium that they were working with to expand the coverage, in some cases for not just employees, but for their families as well. In many cases, we've mentioned reimbursements because this was a big part of what we learned, that very often the big support required was actually a flexibility. In times of the crisis, and especially at the peak during the second wave, we did realize that requesting for bills in the ways that we typically do, requesting for documents in the way that we typically do is not reasonable during a crisis. And so lots of organizations that could set up funds for reimbursements in case healthcare insurance providers would not be able to. I won't take too much time on ESIC, which is a government-supported insurance scheme, because not many organizations were either applicable or used this support. What's also important is the last two bits. Organizations that couldn't keep funds aside to support their teams actually have tried to innovatively find ways to support teams. This was, again, we did the study when everyone was figuring some of these questions out. And so eventually we've seen lots of organizations reach out to GoFundMe campaigns, Milab campaigns, because there aren't dedicated funds and corpuses available, but everybody wants to support their teams in the best ways possible. And different mechanisms for doing so were utilized by teams. So these are just the streams that we saw used by organizations during that time. To quickly move to the next part, which is again around direct health. But we also saw organizations, again, to the best of their capacity and availability of resources, try to support teams in direct health. Some were very directly around awareness and prevention. Organizations in large numbers organized webinars and healthcare sessions for their own teams. First, when the pandemic was starting at the offset for information, now we increasingly see that around vaccination awareness and so on, and my colleague Toral will speak more to that. We've also seen organizations that can have organized pre-screenings of comorbidities for their teams. This was SEVA, it's a fantastic initiative to actually see how teams can be supported before things go bad. In times that things go bad, lots of organizations have actually set up telemedicine facilities, in some cases emergency helpline for if a bed is needed, if oxygen is needed, and so on. So what we saw is a diverse range of ways that organizations have been trying to tackle and support their own teams. The findings in a lot more detail can be found in our report that we will share in a couple of days. But these were some of the ones that stood out for us. For vaccination, I'll hand over to Toral to speak to what the experiences were.
Sure. Thanks, Meeta. So while we saw a lot of organizations making a lot of effort to sort of maximize vaccine coverage, but there were a lot of constraints from the supply side. But nevertheless, there were some of the most commonly taken measures included designing a perception survey tool to understand vaccine hesitancy, to, you know, setting up data tracking systems to track how many employees are vaccinated in every region. And specifically for field teams, this was very, very important because, you know, they go out on the field and to understand in every specific region how many have been vaccinated. I think this was very closely tracked by most organizations. A lot of organizations also created content to spread awareness about vaccination and held a lot of vaccination awareness webinars and virtual sessions to help their teams make an informed decisions. Though we still see that there is some amount of vaccination hesitancy, specifically in field teams, but nevertheless, all organizations have really reached out to support this initiative. And most of the organizations, say about 50% of them, were able to collaborate with corporates to provide vaccination to their staff. And this medium is still being explored very keenly by a lot of other organizations, and they found this as a very useful medium to support free vaccination for their employees. Moving over to mental health. Now, mental health was not a very important support area pre-pandemic, but all organizations we spoke to have made significant efforts towards supporting their teams on this front. So while pre-pandemic, there were set leave policies, now almost all organizations are very flexible to accommodate working hours, leaves, and this plays a very crucial role in supporting teams. They shared that this, just enabled giving teams that mind space to deal with what's happening around them and to, absorb what's happening and still carry on with their work. Another very significant initiative which a lot of organizations did was to create groups and one-on-one sessions for teams to, to be able to freely share what they are feeling on a day-to-day basis and just share about anything and anything that they are feeling at the moment. Another very drastic change which the organizations adopted was just in the way, they do their day-to-day communication. Just reaching out to people to understand how they are doing on a particular day, that really made a lot of difference. I myself remember one of my field teams just sending a message to share, how I'm feeling and that I'm there to support you. I personally feel that really made a difference, and a lot of organizations have shared that they have been doing this, and this has really, really helped, help the teams. Another initiative which was focused on non-work related activities. So a lot of organizations, more than 50% of them, conducted mental health awareness sessions, but in addition to this, conducting sessions on breathing exercises, yoga, meditation, and other fun activities on a more regular basis helped sort of, the teams to keep more sane and help them to cope up with whatever was happening around them. Another significant finding which we had was on counseling and therapy support opportunities, which was again offered by a lot of organizations. And one of the organizations shared that around 40% of their employees actually opted to, utilize these opportunities. And this just highlights the fact that mental health today is so very crucial, and we need support systems from the leadership to sort of support this area. And of course, we'll delve more deeper into this during our panel discussion as well. And another important, and I would say the most important initiative, was to organize frequent discussions with the leadership of the team, specifically for field teams, just to address their insecurities in terms of salaries and leaves and anything else that they were feeling at the moment. Because everybody knew there is a, there's a financial crunch, and there is a, I don't know whether my job is going to last or not. But at such a moment, having a discussion with your leader directly is what really made a difference. And a lot of organizations shared that these sessions have really helped their teams to open up and share their concerns with the leadership. And this just helped build the trust within all the teams. Moving forward to the last piece, which is the support for the families of the deceased. Now, thankfully, a lot of organizations we spoke to did not really experience loss of life, but there aren't any structured policies made around this, though all organizations have really started to pay attention to this piece in general, to see whether there is any financial support that can be offered, to see whether there is any employment support that can be offered to the families of the deceased, and any other mechanisms which are possible. A lot of organizations, in fact, have, their own teams have contributed resources to help the families. But there is still a lot of scope on this at a policy level to sort of come up, and we will definitely delve more deeper into this during our panel as well. So these were some of the key policy pivots that we wanted to share with everyone. And now we will quickly move over to our panel discussion, and I'll take some time to welcome and introduce all our panelists. We have with us Abbas Dadla. Abbas currently leads operations for Acumen Academy in India. In 2014, Abbas was selected as an Acumen India Fellow and has ever since been closely involved with the community, Acumen Community in India Fellows. Prior to joining Acumen, Abbas spent 5 years building Avanti, a social enterprise that combines passionate teachers, world-class curriculum and technology to deliver a high-quality math and science education in the interiors of India. With a desire to understand systemic challenges in India, Abbas subsequently moved on to education and healthcare projects with India's tribal communities and urban poor. Abbas holds a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from IIT Mumbai. Thank you, Abbas, for joining us, and a very warm welcome. We have Ms. Parul Khandelwal, Associate Director, Human Resource, PayPal. Parul is the Associate Director of Human Resources for JPAL South Asia. As the head of HR, Parul contributes strategic guidance and oversight to all HR-related functions with the objective of enhancing internal organizational processes and staff development to allow JPAL South Asia to continue to grow and fulfill its mission. She has 16-plus years of diversified experience in establishing and strengthening HR strategies and systems across digital businesses and social impact organizations. Aside from her leading various HR services, one of her key focus areas is to build the well-being mechanisms of JPAL South Asia's dynamic workforce to overcome and perform during and beyond the pandemic. Thank you, Parul. Thank you for joining us, and a very warm welcome. We also have Smita Mohanty, Head Human Resources Pradhan. Smita is responsible to integrate the human resource development function in Pradhan. After a management education from XIMB in 1989, Smita started her career as assistant manager with Orissa State Oilseeds Growers Federation Limited, a part of Operation Golden Flow in India. She's been part of Pradhan's management unit since 2015 and has completed her 3-year term as a staff member of the governing body of Pradhan in March 2019. She is also part of the steering group of Pradhan's effort of making Pradhan a better place to work for women. She's a member of Industrial Interaction Advisory Committee, Department of Humanities and Social Sciences, IIT Guwahati, a life member of the Institute of Group Facilitation, and an external member of the Internal Complaints Committee of Council on Energy, Environment and Water. A very warm welcome, Smita. Next, we have Neeraj. Neeraj heads Pratham's organizational effectiveness portfolio that focuses on strengthening organizational capacities with a particular focus on people-related systems and professional development to enable Pratham to achieve its strategic goals. Neeraj earlier served as the Associate Director at Evidence for Policy Design India at IFMR, where apart from providing overall executive leadership to the organization, he led its capacity building portfolio focusing on policymakers and government agencies to use evidence and economic theory for decision making. In this role, Neeraj led several training sessions with the Indian Administrative Services officers at the Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy and with state and district officials in Bihar. Neeraj also led EPOD India's policy research engagements in the financial inclusion portfolio. Neeraj graduated from an MPA ID program from Howard Kennedy School. He also holds a postgraduate diploma in management from IIM Lucknow and a degree in chemical engineering from IIT Madras. The panel is going to be moderated by Medha. I briefly spoke about her, but I will also introduce her in detail. So since 2021, Medha has been working with Pratham's Girls and Women programs, supporting strategic initiatives to bridge the learning to livelihood continuum. She has also been working on Pratham's COVID-19 response. Medha earlier co-led Pratham's livelihoods-focused organization, where she spent 5 years scaling the nascent organization, building solutions for workforce development and entrepreneurship. At her time working in skilling, over 80,000 youth received vocational training and jobs, and 2,000 plus women started their own micro enterprises. Medha is passionate about enabling equitable access to learning and work opportunities. She also writes about the same for the Stanford Social Innovation Review, The Guardian, Indian Express, and other publications. Over to you, Medha.
Thank you, Tural. Again, it's great to be a part of this panel and for me to ask you all the questions that I have, may not necessarily have answers to. So I quickly just want to probably start by asking everybody how you've been doing and for you to paint a picture of how your organization's been doing in the last, since March 2020, essentially, how it's changed and how have teams been supported during the time. So, Smita, I'd love to hear about what Pradhan's been doing and your experiences, and especially about how you've been supporting women, since that's an area you're very passionate about as well.
Thank you so much, Medha, for giving this opportunity. And I thank all other panel members also to be with me today. For us, it was very, very important to be with our employees as well as the community. A lot of returnee migrants were going. So for us, it was important that how do we change our strategy from the usual ones? So we started along with the community to community kitchens to provide ration kit for ultra poors. We found out many don't have any support system when the lockdown started. So apart from the awareness campaign, this effort was to have community kitchens, quarantine centers, and then ration kit for the ultra poors. For our own colleagues, we said, let us all stop. But at the same time, we wanted to support the community. So how do we use proper protocol so that we don't fall sick ourselves? Our colleagues actually were exemplary by rushing and supporting the community. I must say, I feel really proud to be a part of this community.
Thanks a lot, Smita. I see it's impossible for anybody of any of us to talk about our own teams without talking to the communities, because they're often so interlinked, right? Quickly like to bring in Neeraj. Since very similar to Smita ji, I think Pratham also works in communities. A lot of our team members come from the very communities that are deeply impacted and that we work for. What's been your experience, Neeraj, of navigating this difficult time? Mute, Neeraj. Neeraj, can you unmute yourself?
सॉरी हाँ मैं अगर बहुत ज़्यादा बोलता हूँ तो प्लीज़ मुझे रोक दीजिएगा. पर मैं मार्च 2020 के बारे में सोच रहा था और वो हम सबके लिए बहुत ज़्यादा कठिन समय था. हमें खुद को नहीं पता था क्या चल रहा है. पहले तो पहली बार हम लोग ऑफिस क्लोजर की बात कर रहे थे. 16 मार्च को प्रथम का ऑफिस क्लोज हुआ. ये मोदी जी ने जब 24 मार्च को लॉकडाउन अनाउंस किया उसके एक हफ्ते पहले ही हमने कर दिया था. पर ये हमारे लिए नई बात थी. हमने कभी हम लोग तो संडे को भी ऑफिस कई बार खुला रहता है, तो हमारे लिए ऑफिस क्लोजर की बात करना पूरे प्रथम में बहुत बड़ी चीज थी. पर साथ साथ एक बहुत कठिन समय हमारे लिए आने लगा, जो था कि बहुत ज़्यादा एंग्जाइटी होने लगी. हम सबको पता था कि इकोनॉमी पूरी तरह से प्रभावित हो रही है. हम न्यूज़ पे देखते थे माइग्रेंट्स के बारे में, और एक बहुत बड़ी आशंका थी कि हमारा खुद का फंडिंग सिचुएशन भी प्रभावित होगा. वो समय और ये कठिन समय में जो हम कहते हैं कि कैसे हमारा पूरा एक स्पिरिट होता है वो सामने निकल के आता है, वो चीज़ जो हमने उस समय की वो काफ़ी काफ़ी हमारे लिए प्रभावशाली रहा है. हमने ये प्रयास किया कि एक बड़ा खतरा था कि हम लोग को सैलरी रिवाइज करना पड़ सकता है, पर वो कम्युनिकेशन हमने कोई ईमेल के साथ नहीं किया. हमारे 6000 लोग हैं प्रथम में, वो कम्युनिकेशन कोई ईमेल के साथ नहीं हुआ. उसके लिए बाकायदा पूरा स्ट्रक्चर बनाया गया. हर व्यक्ति से बात की गई, ग्रुप कॉल किए गए, उनको सिचुएशन समझाया गया. और बहुत कठिन समय था, सबके लिए कठिन समय था. बताया गया कि हमारी फाइनेंशियल परिस्थिति क्या है. बकायदा ग्रुप्स बनाए गए, लीडरशिप ग्रुप्स नेशनल लेवल, स्टेट लेवल पे बात करते थे, स्टेट लेवल, डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल पे बात करते थे. और बाय द एंड ऑफ मई ये स्थिति था, मई या जून में, कि पूरा एक सॉलिडारिटी का फीलिंग था कि हम सब मिलके जो करेंगे मिलके करेंगे और हम सब साथ हैं इसमें. और वो जो स्पिरिट उस समय बना, हमें थैंकफुली कोई सैलरी रिवीजन नहीं करने पड़े, पर वो जो स्पिरिट हमारे लिए उस समय बना वो आगे भी चलता रहा. तो वो एक बड़ी बात मैं कहना चाहूँगा. दूसरा जो चीज़ हमने किया कि जैसा मैं बता रहा हूँ कि हमने अलग अलग तरह के ग्रुप्स, लीडरशिप ग्रुप बनाए थे हर राज्य में। प्रथम 20 से अधिक राज्यों में काम करता है, तो हर राज्य में हमारा एक टास्क फोर्स हमने बनाया जिसे हम कोविड टास्क फोर्स का नाम देते हैं। तो ये लोग ने बहुत विषम परिस्थितियों में लोगों को, चाहे वो फर्स्ट वेव हो चाहे वो सेकेंड वेव हो, अवेयरनेस बताया कि कोविड क्या है, उसके क्या सिम्टम्स होते हैं, वैक्सीनेशन क्यों ज़रूरी है, उनकी भी बाकायदा हमारे पार्टनर संस्थाओं के द्वारा ट्रेनिंग की गई। और जो सेकेंड वेव, जैसा हम सब जानते हैं, ज़्यादा कठिन समय था, तो उसमें इमरजेंसी सपोर्ट दिलाना, लोगों को बेड चाहिए होते थे, परिवार वालों को, हमारे अपने स्टाफ को टेस्टिंग कराना होता था, हॉस्पिटल बेड चाहिए होते थे, रेमडेसिविर चाहिए होता था। तो हमारी टास्क फोर्स उसके पीछे लग गई। हमें बहुत सफलताएं मिली, पर हमें बहुत सारी असफलताएं भी मिली, और वो हम सबको प्रभावित करने लगी थोड़ा सा। तो जब हम मेंटल हेल्थ की बात करते हैं, तो वो एक समय था जो खासकर हम लोग जो उन लोगों की जिंदगियां बचाने में थोड़ा सा जुटे हुए थे, उनके लिए मेंटल हेल्थ एक बहुत बड़ा परेशानी बन गया था, क्योंकि कई बार सफलताएं हो रही थी पर कई बार असफलताएं भी हो रही थी। तो हमने हमारे यूएस में नेटवर्क्स की मदद से, हमारे डॉक्टर्स के साथ नेटवर्क्स की मदद से, बाकी नूरा हेल्थ जैसी कुछ संस्थाएं, उसकी मदद से हमारे लोगों की ट्रेनिंग की, अवेयरनेस किया कोविड को लेके। पर इसके साथ साथ और भी अलग अलग तरह के प्रयास किए गए। मेंटल हेल्थ को लेके हमने एक और संस्था के साथ कुछ प्रयास किए कि हम एक कार्डर बनाए जो कि अगर किसी को भी डिप्रेशन जैसा फील हो रहा है, किसी को भी बात करना है, तो वो लोग कर सकते हैं। इसके साथ साथ और भी अलग तरह के सपोर्ट, चाहे वो फाइनेंशियल, अगर ट्रीटमेंट कॉस्ट के लिए हमने किसी तरह से अपने नेटवर्क की तरह से फंड इकट्ठा करने की के प्रयास किए थे। हमने अपने कुछ लोगों को खोया, हमने कई परिवार साथियों वालों को खोया, पर हमने अपने लोगों को भी खोया। अब उनके परिवारों के लिए हम क्या कर सकते हैं, तो हमारी बोर्ड ने हमारी मदद की है, पर वो हमारे लिए अभी भी चैलेंज है, क्योंकि हम कैसे जो परिवारों ने अपने अर्निंग स्टाफ मेंबर को और प्रथम फैमिली ने जिन लोगों को खोया है, उनको हम लोग किस तरह से बेहतर तरह से सपोर्ट कर सकते हैं। तो मेधा, अभी के लिए मैं इतना ही कहूँगा। मैं श्योर हूँ कि बाकी के सवालों में और चीज़ों पे भी हम बात कर सकते हैं।
थैंक यू नीरज, स्पेशली इस टाइम पे असफलताओं की भी बात करना काफ़ी ज़रूरी है, क्योंकि डिफ़िकल्ट समय था सबके लिए। तो कमिंग टू पारुल, JPAL में काम करते हैं, एंड JPAL इज एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन दैट हैज़ बोथ फील्ड टीम्स with surveyors, but also a large central team. It's a unique organization in its own way. So Parul, if you could also shed some light on what's been your experience. And as all conversations, we should feel free to keep them multilingual and speak in whatever language we're comfortable in. Parul, I'm not listening to you. Can't seem to hear you. If you want to try it without your earphones. Okay. Still can't seem to hear you. If you want to log back in, that's perfectly fine. We'll move to Abbas and come to you. So Abbas works not just with one nonprofit. Through the Acumen Fellowship, works with several nonprofits, and has been helping and supporting teams and talking to teams through their crisis. So Abbas can probably speak not just to Acumen's experience, but what have you been hearing from other organizations in supporting their teams? आई थिंक इसके बाद एक डिस्कशन हमें करना चाहिए जो टेक्नोलॉजिकल डिफिकल्टीज हो रही हैं उस पर भी, क्योंकि दिस सेशन इज अ डेमोंस्ट्रेशन ऑफ हाउ वी हैव बीन ट्राइंग टू वर्क। बट अब्बास, वी कांट हियर यू। पारुल, वी स्टिल कांट हियर यू।
Medha, I would like to come back again.
Sure.
So yes, for the themes, what all we did, I would like to share. So the moment the lockdown was announced, the leadership galvanized, like Neeraj said, we actually decided that nobody will be retrenched. So if we face funding shortage, then we will be actually taking, everybody will be taking salary cuts. So no one will be asked to leave. So that was, and that was shared. Now if people can, Abbas, you can just check, then I'll stop. So.
No, please continue. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
But please continue, Smita ji. I'll come back.
Okay, so that was one that was very important, to tell people that nobody's job will be cut. The second thing, then we said that continuously the ED kept sending emails and communications that please use protocol. If there is comorbidity, please don't go out. Keep yourself inside, isolated. Don't feel anxious that things are not happening. We will go back to our donors saying that we may not be able to achieve what we have decided. So that was, again, one more thing. We are working in such remote areas. Many of our colleagues were young. So we wanted to, they were feeling very isolated, anxiety, a lot of anxiety that parents back home are falling sick. They don't. So medical support many of us were also falling sick. So how do we started webinar with a doctor, and then every day we had a teleconsulting. So those were also things that we started. And if suppose our colleagues had to be transported, then also we other colleagues came out to support, like with this fear that nobody will come and support us, to take us to different hospitals and give the attendance at the time of requirement, providing medicine kit, providing food if somebody is isolated because of the getting affected with COVID. So all those were also happening. And like this medical consultation also, because of the need, we extended it beyond our own kith and kin. Like you can also consult the friends and all. So I'll stop it now. Please, others speak.
I think Smita, you spoke to some very important and crucial points. So I would like to rephrase my question to Abbas a little bit. I feel like lots of difficult conversations around salaries were needed. Lots of difficult financial decisions were needed. And I know one of the big challenges faced by the Acumen community, for instance, was the gap in funds and so on. So if you want to speak to the challenges and constraints faced by organizations during the time, especially when organizations wanted to do what they could for organizations. So if you want to speak to what the experiences of the community were, but also with the financial lens.
Thanks. You can hear me now clearly. Super. Sorry for the tech challenges. It's been a year and a half and I still haven't resolved them. No, but Neeraj ji, when you went back to March and Smita ji, when you spoke as well, and when Medha asked me to be on the panel, the first thing I felt was an imposter. Why am I supposed to be here? Acumen, I'm an employee of Acumen, and I did not have to sort of worry about getting a salary cut or so, because we had a corpus. Most ecosystem enablers never sort of had to worry about the challenges that the implementing organizations they work with faced. So I sort of hold that tension as I sort of even speak here. When March 2020 happened, I think the first conversation internally was our organizations, both Acumen's investees and our fellows, will need contingency cash. Acumen's, if some of you are familiar with Acumen, we run a fellowship for social change makers, and we also sort of focus on impact investing in for-profit social enterprises. What we knew how to do really well is help our for-profit companies with working capital. Right, we have structures in place to sort of do that, but we've never historically, at least in India, ever supported nonprofits financially. And last year was, I think, the first time where in a span of a month and a half, we had to pivot and sort of prioritize nonprofit, our fellows in nonprofit organizations, because March, April was the time where most of the donors were going to be renewing their agreements, right? And I think when we go back to those memories, I think it's just resilience is a tricky word, right? It's been so much forced resilience, and it sort of can open back a lot of the difficult experiences that founders have faced there. But we did an emergency fund, and 66% of it went to nonprofits, which I think I feel like most proud of. And it probably helped reduce some of the guilt of my privilege, right? That I'm not really affected. So we were able to do something in terms of at least helping our fellows keep the lights on. And the big learning there really was, and if I just distill out the couple of learnings, our fellows were pretending to tell us this is their plan with the money, right? Like, this is what they'll do over the next 3 months or 6 months, right? But because we also have deep, honest, authentic relationships with our fellows, because we are not their funders, we knew that they had to make up something, right? In a sense, they needed unrestricted cash to be able to decide what is most relevant in that moment, right? And the big learning there was, as donors, how do you trust your organizations in those moments? We've had some fellows whose long-standing donors just abandoned them overnight and said, hey, why do you need money right now? Programs are paused. If you're in education, we'll come back in September when schools open, right? Like, employees who've been working for that organization for decades can't be told you can't get a salary because you can't go to the field, and it's not like it's not your fault, right? So just to see founders being like, we'll take the salary cut, but our employees need money at the end of the month. And most of them are hand to mouth, right? They can't get their salary 3 months later. So I think that was sort of just what March to June 2020 was all about. I'll pause there.
Okay. I feel like lots of things to unpack there, and we can get into some of those in the next rounds of questions. But I just want to let Parul also have a moment to respond to the question of what JPAL's experience through the last year and a half has been.
Yeah, thanks, Medha. Before I go ahead, am I still audible? Okay, great. Thank you so much for being patient with these tech, scenarios. I think this has actually been one of our biggest learning and continues to be a challenge area, because we work with such geographically diverse teams, not just the field teams, but also the teams who are managing these field teams in response, that while we were pivoting to so many other aspects of managing and leading through the pandemic, technology was always, a muse for us. I agree with Neeraj that, we have not just become patient, but we've also become very smart in finding ways of how to, find multiple uses of technology and how to get our people up to speed with technology. But having said that, stepping, two steps back, way back in March 2020, just before the first lockdown of our lives ever happened, I think for us as well, while creating policies at short notices, really going down the communication cycle so that, their messaging and information is understood clearly across our diverse teams, both in fields as well as in offices, which is then further percolated down to our other stakeholders, like our donors, our partners, our affiliates, our PIs. A common understanding across these various policy changes was happening. There was a general sense of somberness and uncertainty coupled with insecurity amongst everybody. And we felt that something that was very, very important at that time was how to keep spirits of our people up, irrespective of what happens. How do we tie in people and engage them throughout? So something that has actually, started and evolved over a period of 1 year was one of a very popular initiative called Beat the COVID Blues. This is something that we launched as a digital, initiative where all our people, everybody across teams would come together at least fortnightly. And we will talk about how everybody's feeling, but we will also talk about very serious topics of engagement where leadership teams would really, really come forward and guide us, advise us, talk about, you know, aspects of these similar things happening across other organizations, and generally keeping people in good spirits by doing small focused, you know, activities and connecting dots between people looking for parenting tips between pandemic to how to set expectations with, you know, your family members when the lines of working life are really blurring, to how to set expectations with external stakeholders who say that, hey, but we are working, why aren't you coming down, between the various lockdowns that we went through and unlockdowns that we went through. So these Beat the COVID Blues were a combination of lots of activities, initiatives, communication, and it brought us all together irrespective of literally being so geographically apart and in different emotional and well-being phases. We really focused on how people are coping up with their physical health, with their emotional needs, sharing experiences. This was primarily our focus in 2020 in engaging with our people. But on the field side, we did go through similar hiccups like Smitaji and Neerajji were talking about, which was like how to keep our people intact, you know, in the face of what pandemic has brought to us. Many projects were facing standstill. Many field members were going through personal stories and personal scenarios of so much of hardships and challenges. But at the same time, employment. How do we offer them continuity of employment? What do we do about our own people who have worked hard, and now it's times where they were looking for some increase in their income because an annual cycle of increments and, you know, general feedback cycles were there. So general policies were already on our head, but we didn't know how to approach them. So all those pivots were happening at a policy level as well. But we started introducing lots of new additional benefits to our teams. So we started talking about more work-life balance. We started talking about non-working hours, not just working hours. We started saying, hey, we understand that a lot of you don't have anything else to do at work, but that does not mean that you should always be working. What that means is that we have to create more healthy boundaries. What that means is that we have to have healthy working hours. What that means is that we have to have more open communication. And communication should not just be about, you know, resetting of goals and resetting of expectations and changing our reporting structures in the digital format, but also about what is not working. Also about how do we collaborate better in these scenarios? How do we come up with ways and solutions sitting across different, you know, cities and in our smaller or larger rooms with somebody's family, you know, being in the background to somebody's children, to somebody's educational needs, etc. There was a lot of these people, individual and people-centric challenges that were coming in, and our policies were trying to respond to these challenges. So we were allowing people a lot more time off. So we were allowing people a lot more flexibility and freedom to adapt to these changes in terms of even the duties that they were performing. So from, you know, a lot more reporting to much lesser ones, to a much lesser ones to a lot more. So different teams were coming up with their different, you know, models, and we were allowing people the freedom to actually experiment and come up with them and respond to them. And wherever needed, we would also support them with that. So that was primarily happening in 2020. But in 2021, our focus was more in terms of supporting people through their physical and financial hardships, because COVID wave two really brought us to a place where people were facing a lot more in terms of, you know, money matters, in terms of staying healthy and keeping their families healthy. And we were able to support them through a lot of initiatives. We launched something called as JServe, which was actually something that Toril's presentation earlier was talking about. It was a combination of things like supporting people through time, supporting people through money, financial aids that was, you know, much needed, not just for looking at immediate COVID expenses, but also post-COVID recovery expenses. So helping people through all of those scenarios through the JServe, allowing people voluntary time to actually support something that Neeraji was talking about, you know, that remdesivir, which became such an important name in all our lives. But people were even struggling to find authentic information. A lot of field teams did not know what it meant by something like this. And they were going and spending a lot of money, you know, across hospitals, or somebody who would come and tell them, give me 25,000 and this injection will save the life. So how do you give them authentic information? Providing channels of these information, providing forums of these information org-wide and through partner organizations like Noora and many others across these various forums was also happening via the JSERV and many other HR initiatives. So I'll pause there, but this is how our 2020 and 2021 looked like.
Thanks, Parul, and I really appreciate you bridging the two parts, right? Wave one and wave two had very, very different impacts, and all of our learnings in both the waves have been significantly different in both those experiences. I'd actually like to bring Smitaji in. We've been speaking a lot about what are the changes we've made during this time. If you could just also talk about what were the challenges in especially supporting some of these changes, right? For us, we work with, again, lots of teams. There was a lot of upskilling needed on capacities, but in some cases, even that wasn't enough. There were issues of accesses, which only makes me think how much of this will continue for us, right? Remote working and so on. So I just want to hear from you of the challenges that you faced and probably are still facing in this remote form of working.
Yeah, one of the most important thing was most of our work was community capacity building. So we had to quickly change in our format. Our usual format is to visit the field and work with them. So how do we start our virtual training and capacity building initiatives? All the whole of Pradhan had to learn how to do virtual training and capacity, and not only to the master trainers. The master trainers also needed to understand how to train the other community members. So they also have, like you said, they did not have a mobile phone which are compatible to online training. So how to support that? What can be done? So 2-3 trainers, if one has a proper, which can accept the kind of training program that we want to provide. So those were the things that we ourselves, the HR unit, was struggling. There are so many training programs we give to our employees. So how do we, and most of them again were through physical. So how do we change the curriculum? How do we format it in a manner that in online they can be given, so that the training needs of our own staff is also met? So those are very, very important to do. Also the programming, our own programming had to change. So I'm very happy to say that though we had changed our, we said, okay, do we need to make our annual plan to be toned down, but actually at the end of 20 we found that we have almost achieved that or even more along with the COVID work that we did. So that was very, very important. Remote work, like Parul was saying, though our work hours sometimes increase, but at the same time, we also made it flexible during the remote work. And many of our colleagues, like Lexi said, they don't have something when the office closes, like the colleagues who are assisting in the office, maybe the front office or the attendants. So we said it's okay, you can continue, and their salary were given as such. So a lot of this kind of changes has to be made, but we have to keep innovating. The dashboard that we created to so that people can support the colleagues who are falling ill, go to their place, provide food and support, medicine support, wherever required. So those were many things that we never had done earlier, but we jumped into those, and how to make the technology better, because in those remote areas, this is a very big issue. I'll stop here.
Yeah, Smitaji, also for subsequent answers, if you could speak a little loudly. I've received a couple of messages that your voice is a little low.
Okay.
Much better. Perfect. Sounds good. So Smitaji has also highlighted a lot of learnings that we've had during the time. I'd quickly just like to bring in Neeraj here. Lots of learnings happening. Is there anything you fear we'll go back to without realizing? Are there things that you've learned during this time and the organization has learned during this time that you fear we will elastically go back to doing, that you'd want to hold on to? Just as an example, I can say one of the things mentioned by Toral was a lot of mental health support was provided during this time, which wasn't a focus so much earlier. But are there any other learnings about organizational effectiveness that you've had because of the pandemic that you'd want to hold on to?
ठीक है तो होल्ड ऑन टू में तो बहुत बहुत सारी चीज़ें हैं. हमने प्रथम के कुछ पहले भी सेशन हुए थे पर हमारा काम भी हमने पिवट किया. तो आई थिंक एवरीथिंग वी डिड फॉर आवर टीम्स इज ऑल्सो एंकर्ड अराउंड कि हमने कम्युनिटीज़ के साथ काम कैसे पिवट किया. तो वी स्टार्टेड ऑपरेटिंग रिमोटली. वी हैड अ कैंपेन कॉल्ड करोना अपनी सुरक्षा. अभी वी हैड अ कैंपेन कॉल्ड करोना अपनी थोड़ी मस्ती थोड़ी पढ़ाई पिछले साल. और जहाँ हमें जैसे भी मौका मिलता था हम लोग फील्ड मूवमेंट स्टार्ट कर लेते थे क्योंकि वहीं से हमको अपनी एनर्जी आती है. कुछ चीज़ें अच्छी हुई हैं. मैं पहले हम लोग को काफ़ी ट्रेनिंग करना रहता है हमारे काम के लिए, कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग करना रहता है. और स्काइप पहले भी था, जूम अभी ज़्यादा बढ़ गया है पर पहले स्काइप हुआ करता था पर मुझे नहीं लगता उसका हम इतना अच्छा इस्तेमाल कर पाते थे. तो सबसे बड़ी बात जो, और मैं शायद गलत हो सकता हूँ पर मेरे जहाँ तक मुझे नॉलेज है, ये हमने मार्च से स्टार्ट किया. हमने एक इवेंट करना चालू किया हर सैटरडे को, हर लगभग हर सैटरडे को होता था जिसे हम रूबरू कहते थे. इसमें पूरे प्रथम के, मतलब अपेक्षा ये है कि पूरे प्रथम की फैमिली एक दूसरे को देखे, जुड़े, बात करे. और उसमें हमारे सेशंस होते थे, कभी हमारे लीडर्स के सेशन होते थे, कभी वो बात करते थे अपने अनुभव के बारे में, कई बार हमारी बाकी टीम्स अपने अनुभव के बारे में, अपने चैलेंजेस के बारे में, अपने काम के बारे में. और मुझे लगता है कि ये ज़रूर बरकरार रहना चाहिए. कभी भी हम फुल रिटर्न टू फुल नॉर्मल कभी जब करेंगे तो ये ज़रूर बरकरार रहना चाहिए. दूसरा कि अगेन एक मैं ट्रेनिंग और कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग के व्यू पॉइंट से कहूँगा कि हम लोग पहले कुछ ट्रेनिंग सेंटर्स हैं हमारे और जहाँ हमारी स्टाफ की कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग के लिए हम लोग वर्कशॉप्स करते हैं तो सारा काम रुक जाता है. दो एक महीने के लिए, 30 दिन के लिए, 15 दिन के लिए लोग आते हैं, एक ट्रेनिंग होता है, उसके बाद वापस चले जाते हैं. पर अब वो बहुत असिमिलेट हो गया है डे टू डे काम में. तो अभी हमारा कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग वर्क जो हम जिस तरह से करते हैं, एवरी वीक कुछ हो रहा है, उसका कुछ स्ट्रक्चर्ड रूटीन बन पा रहा है. उसमें भी हम 4-4 क्लासेस ब्रेकआउट रूम्स कर सकते हैं जो पहले हम नहीं कर पाते थे. तो एक बहुत अच्छा अपॉर्चुनिटी है. थोड़े से चैलेंजेस भी हैं, मैं चैलेंजेस पे आऊँगा, पर बहुत अच्छा अपॉर्चुनिटी आ गया है हमारे पास कि हम लोग अपनी टीम्स की कैपेसिटी बिल्डिंग पे थोड़ा और बेहतर तरह से काम कर सकें. एक अनुभव जो मैं ज़रूर शेयर करना चाहूँगा कि अभी 2-3 दिन पहले की बात है, हमने एक बर्थडे सेलिब्रेट किया और काफ़ी अच्छा लगा हमें. अचानक 15 मिनट पहले हमने डिसाइड किया चलो सेलिब्रेट करते हैं, सब लोगों को बुला लिया, टीम पूरी ज्वाइन हो गई, बहुत अच्छा माहौल बना और बर्थडे सेलिब्रेट किया. मुझे नहीं लगता कि हम लोग आज से 2 साल पहले उस तरह से करते थे. एक ऑफिस में कर लेते थे पर प्रथम इतना बड़ा नेटवर्क है, इतनी बड़ी फैमिली है कि वो जो प्रेजेंस है वो केवल उस ऑफिस तक ही सीमित रहता. अभी हमारे पास बहुत अच्छी अपॉर्चुनिटीज़ है उस कनेक्शन को और बेहतर बनाने के लिए और बेहतर करने के लिए. हम लोग हमारे प्लानिंग के जो काम होते हैं वो अब हम हर थर्सडे हमारा एक प्लानिंग नेशनल लेवल पे मीटिंग होता है, गेट टुगेदर होता है कि कौन क्या कर रहा है, एक दूसरे सीख के. तो अपॉर्चुनिटीज ज़रूर है, मैं ये नहीं कहूँगा हमने पूरी तरह से उन पर कैपिटलाइज किया है, चैलेंजेस भी बहुत सारे हैं. तो एक जो चीज़ हमने की थी जिसमें मैं थोड़ी देर बात करना चाहूँगा, एक साल पहले लगभग इसी समय जब थोड़ा सा फर्स्ट वेव ख़त्म हुआ था तो हमारी एक मीटिंग हुई थी कि कैसे हमारी वर्क लाइफ पॉलिसी बने. बहुत डिस्कशन हुआ कि हम लोग 9 बजे के पहले कोई कॉल नहीं करेंगे, 6 बजे के बाद कोई कॉल नहीं करेंगे. मुझे नहीं लगता हम लोग कितने सफल हुए उस पर. तो वो नहीं हुआ और उसमें नुकसान हो रहा है क्योंकि और उसमें एक बहुत जेंडर बेस्ड फोकस भी है जो मुझे जितना उससे इतना नहीं डील करना पड़ता पर मैं जानता हूँ कि कई महिला साथियों को करना पड़ता है. क्योंकि हम लोग एक टाइम डिसाइड कर लेते हैं सुबह 9 बजे पर, अब वो संभव नहीं है. कई ऐसे उदाहरण सामने आए कि हमारे कई साथी कॉल लेने के लिए उनके घरों में कॉल नहीं चलता है तो उनको कॉल लेने के लिए एक खेत में जाके कॉल लेना पड़ता है. उसकी वजह से उनको घर वालों से बाहर वालों की बातें भी होने लगती हैं. मैं पिछले एक महीने पहले कॉल में था, मैं खुद ही कर रहा था, और हमारे एक साथी, बहुत की साथी हैं, हम लोग सोशल प्रोटेक्शन पे भी काफ़ी काम करते हैं अपने टीम्स के लिए, तो वो उनकी लाइट चली गई थी, तो वो कॉल लेने के लिए एक दुकान से कॉल ले रहे थे, कपड़ों की दुकान में बैठे हुए थे। अब ये सारी चीज़ें हैं, ये स्ट्रगल है, ये एक्चुअल स्ट्रगल है जो हम लोगों को इतना फेस नहीं करना पड़ता है, पर हमारी टीम्स जो कि रूरल और सेमी रूरल लोकेशंस में हैं, उन लोगों को काफ़ी फेस करना पड़ता है। और जो एक बड़ा चैलेंज हमको आता है कि जब सेकेंड वेव आता है तो हमारी मानसिकता टीम्स को सपोर्ट करने की हो जाती है पूरी तरह से। जब धीरे धीरे सेकेंड वेव थमने लगता है तो हमें काम भी तो आगे बढ़ाना है, तब हमारा मानसिकता होता है काम आगे बढ़ाना। पर बहुत सारे जो स्ट्रगल्स हैं, जब सेकेंड वेव पूरे इंडिया में खत्म हो, ऐसा नहीं हुआ कि बिहार में हमारे किसी साथी के परिवार में प्रॉब्लम नहीं हो रहा, वो हो रहा है, वो वहां पे भी हो रहा है। तो ये एटीट्यूड कि हम लोग अपनी टीम्स को सपोर्ट करें वाइल मैनेजिंग वर्क, वो कम से कम मेरे लिए बहुत बड़ा स्ट्रगल रहा है, और मुझे पता है काफी लीडर्स के लिए स्ट्रगल रहता होगा कि हम लोग एक समय एम्पैथी हमारे लिए डोमिनेंट होता है, बट कुछ देर बाद वर्क हमारे लिए डोमिनेंट होता है और होना भी चाहिए, वहीं से तो हमें अपनी, इसीलिए तो हम लोग जाने जाते हैं, पर उसको बैलेंस कैसे बनाए रखना वो एक बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज है। हम उसको कैसे, उससे क्या सीखते हैं, शायद वो जब नॉर्मल पूरी तरह से सिचुएशन हो तो भी हम लोग कुछ बेहतर इंसान बन के निकलेंगे।
थैंक यू नीरज, बहुत सारे थम्स अप्स दिखे, तो काफी लोग रिलेट कर रहे थे वो जो पॉइंट आपने खाने के बारे में।
जिनके मैं उदाहरण दे रहा हूँ वही तो थम्स अप नहीं दे रहे हैं।
बिल्कुल। तो अब आज यही प्रश्न कि आपको क्या लगता है हम कौन सी चीजों को होल्ड ऑन करें, एंड स्पेसिफिकली अगर और पर्सपेक्टिव से भी बात करें कि फ्रॉम अ फाउंडर चीफ एग्जीक्यूटिव को क्या चीजें होल्ड ऑन करनी चाहिए, जो शायद अभी जो भी लीडरशिप पोजीशंस में हैं उन्होंने उनको फोर्स ऑलमोस्ट फील हुआ करना, बट दे शुड कंटिन्यू दिस ड्यूरिंग अ नॉर्मल टाइम, एंड द अदर फ्रॉम द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ ऑल्सो फंडर्स एंड पीपल हु पुट इन द फिलैंथ्रोपिक कैपिटल, नॉट टू पास ऑन द बक एंड से द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी लाइज देयर, बट व्हाट, हाउ डू यू थिंक आर पॉइंट्स दैट बोथ ऑफ देम शुड कीप इन माइंड गोइंग फॉरवर्ड एंड होल्ड ऑन टू।
Thank you, Meera. I'm looking at the comments also. Arjun, great questions. And again, none of us have answers. We are not experts on the panel, but these are questions we are holding. I think Smritaji and Neeraj covered it really well, so I won't re-explain a lot. But I think one thing I've realized was that before the pandemic, a lot of the decisions were taken by people who believe that they are the ones who need to take the decisions, right? So if it's a funder and a founder relationship, the funder is the one sort of, not dominating, but sort of the one where power sort of sits, right? And if it's founders and teams, then again, the founders are responsible for designing policies, work culture, etc., right? I think the pandemic flipped all of that, right? Wherein funders listen to founders, right? Saying, hey, tell us what you need, and we'll be there, right? And I think it's easy to sort of trash donors, right, and say, you know, y'all don't listen, y'all are dominant, right? But in the pandemic we saw how people have given tons of money without due diligence, right? You can't go on the ground, you can't see people on the basis of trust and quickly, right? Trust first, paperwork later. People have given money, and similarly founders have had to trust their teams, right? Saying, hey, I know you have constraints and stuff. If you're with your video off on morning calls, or if you need flexibility of working hours, the default is to trust, right? I think when we go back, I think there isn't going to be a one-stop solution, right? It won't be the same for all. There's many organizations that when we speak to some of the team members are yearning to go back to an office because their homes are not conducive spaces to work out of. I remember in September last year when the first wave receded a little, one of the organizations that had limited money actually decided to pick up all of their team members and huddled, took a bungalow on rent and moved all of them there because they were, the employees were predominantly women and they weren't really allowed to work at home because a lot of household cores and responsibilities were sort of expected out of them, right? And a lot of their work on women empowerment was actually like going back, right? And they could see it literally in their own teams. So they just decided to move all of them up. They did all the protocols and actually worked out of a bungalow for 2 months. And the team members would say that that's the best 2 months of their year, right? Where they had freedom, right? And I think you can't quantify the value of some of that. And there are others who are much more productive at home, right? And can save the amount of travel back and forth from their workspaces and don't really need to be in offices regularly. So I think it's going to be this constant dance of listening to needs of people and designing accordingly, right? I think flexible policies are going to be the way to go. I'm hearing of many organizations. I think, again, we learn a lot from the US and the West, right? Like, oh, we've given up our offices and we're going to be permanently working from home. And there are many people who are like, no, I can't have that happen, right? I can just quickly speak from first person, right? While I'm privileged, I have a home in Bombay. My wife and me working out of the same room on Zoom calls just did not work out after three months, right? And my parents and my sister, five of us in a home that normally two, three people are staying in, sort of just got to us after a point, right? So, I mean, it's hard to quantify some of those needs that our employees and our team members have. I feel like I reiterated a lot of the points and it didn't make a lot of sense, but sorry, I'll pause.
No, Baz, experiences are uniformly similar, but everybody's points and insights are still adding to the conversation. Parul, again, to ask you about JPAL's experience and your experience of working with the team, what do the next few months look like in terms of priorities from human resource policies, things that you're going to change, things you're going to keep? What's the start, what's the stop, what's the grow for what you're doing right now?
Yeah, so that's a great question, Medha. But before that, I do want to also add on the previous question that in terms of new adaptations that we have done as an organization, as a team, that we do want to continue and we would want to see whether and what will it take for us to continue are two broad things. One is, as an organization, because of the need of the pandemic, we had to really work on quick ramp ups and ramp downs of our research work. Okay, now this is something which was very new, from ramping up in less than 2 weeks within the field, because you want to really make most of a window between two waves. One which you don't know when it's going to come and one which you know has just ended, so to speak. And two, responding to all these changing dynamics around, you don't know what government would announce tomorrow. People may have different scenarios. So you really want to make use of that time. So you need to ramp up very quickly. At the same time, be prepared and ready from top to bottom to be able to ramp down also very quickly. So the moment you know that on ground reality is telling you that your team safety is at stake, that this may cause concern and challenges for people, and you really need to ramp down the full operations at scale very quickly. This quick ramp up and ramp down, while we have adapted to it very nicely, we have adopted it very nicely, how do we continue this in the future? Because I agree with Abbas and Neeraj to say that, flexibility is the new normal. Nothing else is going to be the new normal for us, but for us to be really agile, for us to be really able to make decisions very quickly and stay that flexible, because the face of the uncertain tomorrow is not known to us. One thing that pandemic taught us all is the fact that you don't know what will hit you tomorrow, but you need to be ready to take the bull by its horn when it hits you, right? So how do we stay agile in that context? How do we ensure that we continue to be quick in our ramp ups and ramp downs? That's one adaptation, which is also a question for us, which is also something which is very important for our future, both in the 6 months, 12 months and 24 months of a cycle for us. The other thing is, utilization of our people in terms of their capacities. Many people were, partially engaged, many were not, because pandemic led to scenarios where some projects could happen, some could not, some could partially happen. At JPAL, we always kept safety prima facie in our operations. We said, if it's not safe, we're not going to do it. right? And it was a choice for our teams and our projects. Having said that, what happens tomorrow? How do we then talk about and think about safety of our teams? Does it change? If it doesn't, how do we plug that in into our business decisions, in our key plans? How do we plug that in? Today, we have pivoted to digital modes of interacting with our government partners, stakeholders, donors. How do we do that in the future? What is it that we can take away? So technical adaptations should not change. In fact, they should keep growing with time. So using technology and leveraging on it in a very, very deep way from top to bottom. Because today, my field teams, when they were collecting data earlier on tabs, now they're doing phone collection of data. And you know, with all the personal challenges that Neeraj was also talking about, they're very similar. But at the same time, when people are going into the field and they are doing this data collection, they also have to be trained digitally. We found some strengths and some challenges in that. How do we carry forward those strengths? Just because in one, a couple of months, we may go back to being in offices. We may go back to saying trainings can happen in offices, but right now we have an advantage of that. How are we going to continue that in the future? These are some thoughts for us to look towards, I think, primarily. And also in terms of engaging our people, the capacities that we have been able to redeploy. Because at JPAL, we said, we're not going to lay off anyone. We will redeploy people. We were very successful in doing that. But can that strategy continue? Because it's not it was pandemic driven, but it should continue to stay at scale for us. These are some initial things that I thought I can share with everyone.
This is very helpful. So maybe this time in the reverse order, we can do a round of questions. Parul, again to you then. You spoke a lot to the agility that's needed and building that agility and that muscle to continuously change requires investment in teams and building of capacities. Yeah. What's something that you've, again, done during this time? What's something that you think is going to be done differently going forward?
So technical adaptation is actually very, very important. Adoption and adaptation. Ensuring that technology continues to be used in a much deeper way. When we started our digital data collection, we also introduced practices where we would talk about health status every day of every person. From a 800 to 1,000 field team, every day looking at everybody's health status and saying, yes, you're good to go into the field. That was huge. How do we continue to build capacities of our team to continue looking at that large scale data, assimilating and synthesizing that large scale data and taking decisions on day-to-day basis this. So if 10 people in one project, out of them two report back with symptoms of fatigue, fever, or anything else, how do they redeploy that? Taking that decision quickly early on in the day so that the day is still utilized. To actually thinking at it from a team level and a management level, how do you use all that information over a period of time, weeks and months, to say what are your team's needs in terms of using that data, understanding that data, using technology to leverage on those kind of decisions and important insights? I think that is a very, very important need for people to be trained on. Also, mental health. See, providing support right now is the immediate need, but also enabling people to be able to respond to mental health needs in a longer term, and enabling people to think about it more from a cultural way and not just as an immediate need is something that we feel we want to build capacities, especially of people who are role playing as managers, so that it's not just, it's unfortunate that mental health needs have really gone up during the pandemic, but it is not unheard of that mental health has always been a challenge. And it's just that we are now seeing more information about people who are struggling about it or people who are asking for it. But that also puts an important question to us that how about in future, are our managers, our leaders capable of understanding the mental health needs and then responding to those challenges? Can they at least give first aid to teams who've come up with mental health challenges on a day-to-day basis? I think those are some important capacity building needs for us. But other than that, at JPAL, we've generally really had progressive capacity building needs, and they will continue, from aspects like virtual collaborations to better management of hybrid teams. I think that's something which has always been progressive for us at JPAL, because we have always had very diffused teams. geographically quite decentralized. So those are normal capacity needs for us.
Can't hear you, Medha.
Yeah, we can't hear you, Medha.
Can't hear you, Medha.
Audible now?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. I'm just going to keep my video off for the question. So Abbas, just to bring you in right here, to add to what Parul said about capacity building, both technical capacities, but also managerial capacities and support capacities. It would be great to hear of your experiences in the pandemic using the opportunities that like being able to go remote has allowed, but challenges of that as well. And where do you see going forward?
Yeah, I think we're all sort of in this constant boat, right? I think Tanvi, Arjun, and all of us are sort of, I think, speaking similarly. One of the things I think that was coming to my mind might not exactly be linked to the question, Medha, but I think we've been very reactive in a sense, sort of, I mean, if the Olympics sort of maybe are an example, right? Like right after the Olympics, we're like, hey, why aren't we investing in sports development in India enough, right? And then sort of we forget the conversation and we move forward, right? When COVID hits, we're like, oh, you know, our health infrastructure is sort of broken X, Y, Z. But then sort of we again go back to what we're doing, right? I think one of the big questions that I've been sitting with and I know a lot of our fellows have been sitting with is what changes in our mission statements after everything we've experienced, right? And a first wave that we thought was devastating, and then we experienced a second wave, right? And our communities are no longer the same, right? Like the communities might be the same, but their needs, their priorities have shifted so much, right? So similarly, I think our field staff are picking those things up, right? Our field staff who are connected closely with the communities are sensing different needs, right? But then as soon as we come back from a wave, we sort of go back to our own mission statement, right? So is there an opportunity to listen closely to people working most closely to the ground around what needs to change in the organization? It often feels like some of our field staff want to know that they want to do A, but they're forced to do B because that's again what we've signed up with our donors or our missions, etc., right? So again, and we all of us sort of abandoned everything we were doing in April and May this year, right? And there was just SOSs happening across. It doesn't matter who you are, right? If you need remdesivir, we'll help you get there, right? We'll collaborate with people. But the wave's over and no one's talking about anything, and like everyone's going back to their individual missions, right? So I feel like there is an opportunity here to sort of go back to the drawing board and include, I think, our field staff here, right? Because they're closest to the ground to sort of know what needs to shift. A lot more of Acumen fellows have now incorporated healthcare in their work, right? A lot of their field staff have now been trained on vaccination hesitancy. They've been trained on various other sort of medical protocols. And there is an opportunity to sort of continue investing in some of that for them. So I know I'm not exactly sort of linking to the question, but that was sort of live. So that we just don't go back and have sort of some of these vulnerabilities in our society exposed and then not really addressed systemically. Yeah, I'll pause there because I know this is my last opportunity to speak here.
No, there's a little more time left. And again, Neeraj, feel free to use my questions as just springboards to talk about anything else that you may want to. For you, any other areas of support that you're looking at for sure. Capacity building? What's been the experience?
No, I think it's at various levels. Pehle to we exist because of the goals that we have set for ourselves in education. और उसमें बहुत 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 बदलाव हुआ है, बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज आया है, तो वो देखते हुए हमको अपनी रणनीति कैसे बदलनी चाहिए, नॉट जस्ट टेम्पररी, अगले अगले एक दो महीने में हमको क्या करना चाहिए, पर क्या हमें गर्ल्स ड्रॉप आउट होने की बहुत बड़ी संभावना है, क्या हमारी गवर्नमेंट पार्टनरशिप्स और उनकी कैपेसिटीज, टीचर्स की कैपेसिटीज टू कंडक्ट क्लासेस रिमोटली वो कितनी है। आने वाले सालों में ये एक बात हमें पता लग गई है कि ये कोई आखिरी बार पैंडमिक नहीं होगा, ये दोबारा होगा, बार बार होगा मान लीजिए, तो हमारे लीडरशिप की, हमारी टीम्स की कैपेसिटीज स्ट्रैटेजिकली सोचने के लिए कि हमको कौन से एरियाज में जाने की ज़रूरत है, और जैसा अब्बास कह रहे हैं जहाँ नहीं जाने की ज़रूरत है, क्योंकि जैसा रिएक्टिव हो जाता है, कई बार अभी सेकेंड वेव आया तो हम लोग बहुत सारा कॉन्सेंट्रेटर्स ले रहे हैं, ये कर रहे हैं, वो अच्छी बातें हैं, उस समय ज़रूरी होता है, पर एजुकेशन में भी बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज है हमारे सामने, हर लेवल पर है। कई बच्चे प्राइवेट स्कूल बंद हो गए, प्राइवेट स्कूल से ड्रॉप आउट हो गए, अब तो बच्चों को, मैं एक मीटिंग में हम लोग ये सुन रहे थे कि बच्चों को पता ही नहीं हो किस क्लास में है। तो ये सब सिचुएशन को देख के हम लोग अपनी रणनीति को कैसे बदल सकते हैं आने वाले कई सालों के लिए, और उसके लिए हमको किस तरह की कैपेसिटीज बिल्ड करनी जरूरी होगी, तो पहला तो वही हो जाता है। दूसरा ऑफ कोर्स आता है, और जो एक बहुत बड़ा अपॉर्चुनिटी है हमारे पास कि हम इस तरह की चर्चाएं कर रहे हैं, और जहां तक पहले हम लोग एक बड़े बड़े होटल के कॉन्फ्रेंस रूम में मिलते थे, कुछ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन से सीखते थे, पर आज हम लोग यहाँ प्रदान है, सेवा है, जेपाल है, एक्यूमेन है, प्रथम है, बहुत आसानी से, क्योंकि हम सब उसी परिस्थिति से जूझ रहे हैं। आपने किस तरह से इसे किया, हम इसे किस तरह से कर सकते हैं, क्या हम मिलकर काम कर सकते हैं। पिछला जो सेशन था जिसमें ग्रामवाणी थी, हक दर्शक थे, उनसे भी बहुत कुछ सीखने को मिल सकता है। तो ये एक बहुत बड़ा अपॉर्चुनिटी हमारे पास है एक दूसरे से सीखने का। तीसरा तो ऑफकोर्स यही है कि हमारा डिजिटल कैपेसिटीज, हमारे लोगों का, चाहे वो अगर डेटा कलेक्शन है तो हम लोग रिमोट डेटा कलेक्शन के क्या प्रोसेसेस और सिस्टम्स हो सकते हैं। डिजिटल कंटेंट को लेके हमने बहुत कैपेसिटीज बिल्ड करने की कोशिश की है। पर एक चीज जो मैं बार बार कह रहा हूँ और जिससे हम लोग सब जूझते हैं, वो है परफॉर्मेंस मैनेजमेंट कैसे होगा, क्या हमको, हाउ डू वी डू परफॉर्मेंस मैनेजमेंट विथ एम्पैथी बट वी ऑल्सो डू नॉट कॉम्प्रोमाइज ऑन वर्क। ऐसा ना हो कि नहीं चलो इस साल जो हो रहा है होने दो, ऐसा नहीं होता है। वी आर ऑल अकाउंटेबल टू आवर डोनर्स। तो रिमोट रहते हुए विथ एम्पैथी हमारी लीडरशिप की एबिलिटीज, हमारे मैनेजर्स की एबिलिटीज को बहुत हमें स्ट्रेंथन करने की जरूरत होगी, और इसमें बहुत सारे रिसर्च की भी बहुत जरूरत है। तो पारुल है कॉल पर, पर कैसे किया जा सकता है, व्हाट आर सम प्रोसेसेस दैट कैन वर्क, हमें सोचने की जरूरत है।
तो इसी से मैं स्मिता जी के लिए आखिरी सवाल पे आती हूँ। स्मिता जी, ये सवाल मुझसे और नीरज से कॉन्फ्रेंस में पूछा गया था, जिसका हम सोच रहे थे हमारे पास ज़्यादा अच्छा जवाब नहीं है, इसलिए इस पैनल से पूछना चाहिए। हम एक पैनल पे थे जहाँ पर अफ्रीका के काफ़ी ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस थे जब वेव उनका आने वाला था, और उन्होंने पूछा था दैट नाउ दैट इंडिया हैज़ गॉन थ्रू अ सेकेंड वेव, वॉट आर लर्निंग्स फॉर अस टू प्रिपेयर। बट अगर वही सवाल हम अपने लिए सोचें कि जो हमने सीखा है सेकेंड वेव से, how do we prepare especially for our own teams, the support we provide our own teams, what would we do differently, or how can we prepare better? Smita ji, if you have any closing thoughts on that or anything else you may want to mention.
Yeah, jaise Parul boli, it is very important to be flexible, to be patient, to be resilient, and we don't know what will happen tomorrow, so every day one is also living with the fear that third wave kab aayega. सो विथ दैट, लाइक जैसे नीरज ने बोले कि हमारा काम से ही हमको खुशी मिलता है, तो हाउ डू वी अडेप्ट आवर सेल्फ टू वर्क इन ए वे दैट वी कैन डू वट एवर वी वॉन्ट टू डू इन ए डिफरेंट वे। सो वो बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है। एंड हाउ डू वी सेंसिटाइज आवर फंडर्स, कोई लिखा था कि हाउ कैन फंडर्स सपोर्ट फॉर द थिंग्स दैट वी वॉन्ट टू डू, सो दैट आर colleagues' mental health is at peace to do the kind of important works that one needs to do. So ये बहुत ही ज़रूरी है कि हम adapt कैसे कर पाएँ, हम हर वक्त open कैसे रह सकें, and we do things in a way that it impacts even if with all odds. यही मैं बोलूँगी। ये मेंटल हेल्थ का कंटिन्यू क्या करना है, इट इज़ इम्पोर्टेंट टू कंटिन्यू ऑन मेंटल हेल्थ। हम खुद सोच रहे हैं कि लिसनिंग सर्कल्स हमारे टीम्स के लिए हम बनाए, एनवीसी ऑफर करता है मिसलिंग सर्कल्स, सो कैसे हम वो मिसलिंग सर्कल्स कंटिन्यू करें ताकि पीपल आर ऑलवेज अंडरस्टैंडिंग ईच अदर. सो ये अंडरस्टैंड क्या है ना, जो वीडियो ऑफ करके जब हम बात करते हैं इतने बड़े बड़े कॉन्फ्रेंस, हम नहीं जानते व्हाट दिस पर्सन इज गोइंग थ्रू एट दिस पॉइंट इन टाइम. सो वो कैसे हमको हर वक्त हम अलर्ट रहे, सेंसिटिविटी हमारा रहे कि जो सामने है वो किस परिस्थिति में हो सकती है. इट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू बी अंडरस्टैंडिंग. विद दैट आई विल स्टॉप.
थैंक यू. क्विकली द सेम क्वेश्चन पारुल.
So Medha, if you don't mind, would you please repeat the question?
Question is, what would you do different? What can we learn from what's already happened, and what would you do differently to prepare for anything similar in the future?
So I would actually respond to this in a different manner. I would say that something that has worked for us with respect to the question that Neeraj raised, and also Smita ji in a way answered about, you know, what do we really define as success and performance? I think that is a bigger question for us to ask, rather than to look back and say, okay, we've done so much and this seems fantastic, but maybe this wasn't what we should have. Instead of that, how do we more frequently ask ourselves the question that, what do we call as success? How does the definition of success changes for us? And what do we call as performance? What does excellence means to us versus what does, you know, something average means to us? And literally use this at every level, at an individual level, at a team level, even at an organizational level for CXOs. For them, I think that kind of agile mindset and thinking is what we need. And this is something which we have tried. Sometimes we have failed, sometimes we have succeeded. But this is something which, in my personal experience, I think would be a great value add, both for our HR structures as well as for our overall, you know, strategic direction for our organizations. Because this is something which is my personal takeaway from this pandemic.
Okay, rethinking the definition of success. That's very helpful. Neeraj?
I think I've covered a lot of these things already. So should we, we don't have enough time, right? Do we, Medha? Should we move
to question and answers? Yes, I've asked if you have any closing thoughts on that, otherwise we'll quickly bring in the questions.
None, go ahead.
Okay, so lots of questions have come in, some in the Q&A section, but some also on the chat.
Sorry, Medha, can I just add one last thing? I think that something that we have not, something that we can do better in the coming times is, while we think about all these different moving pieces across our organizations, from leadership to people to our operational, you know, strategies, I think something from the leadership team that I would really like to see across the board is more of role modeling. We can think of a lot of, different ways of managing and different styles. But I think it's very, very important, especially in our social impact organizations, because these are very purpose-driven organizations. And a lot of this culture, a lot of our actions are literally, inspired. And if we could look at role modeling from the leadership about the way we work, and about all our definitions and reviews and mechanisms, I think it could be a very interesting way forward in the new normal, so to speak.
Okay, lots of thumbs up right there. Neeraj, a question that we've received. Do you think CSOs and nonprofit staff are more vulnerable than other industries? If yes, how do we address the problem? Long-term, short-term solutions. This is from Arjun Agarwal.
Yeah, I wished he asked an easier question than this. I don't know what we mean by other sectors. Of course, government, the ASHA workers and the Anganwadi workers and the policemen, they were much, the doctors, the nurses, they were much more vulnerable than frontline teams. But yes, they are vulnerable. It's a matter of how do we sort of work on strengthening their awareness, but also something that Parul mentioned, how do we equip them to take decisions very locally if things are, and trust them with those decisions. If things are deteriorating in a particular community, how do we enable them to take that decision that they should stop movement but we'll need to constantly work with them to increase awareness, increase precautions. At the same time, there's also one thing, right? A lot of us, we derive our energies from the children we work with, from the communities that we work with. So at one level to say that we should protect mental health, and at one level to say that we should be very like over cautious with movement, I don't think that happens together, right? So some of our new joinees, they are just visiting field, and I think they have never had a better time at Pratham in the last 6-8 months than they are having now. And that's where the energies come from. So for me, I think stopping field movement is often not the solution. Just equipping them, preparing them, and enabling them, and trusting them with those decisions about how they should go about their movement. And of course, vaccination ke piche to lag jana hoga. We have to really, really, really listen to them if they are hesitant. We have to really work with them if they are not getting access to vaccination. We have a high percentage of vaccinated staff in Pratham, but we have still not reached 100%. And that last mile is the most difficult. And we need to really listen to them, because trying to do that by coercion is not going to happen.
Fantastic. Smitaji, there's another question that says speed is very critical during these times. What was it about your organization that allowed you and Pradhan to work at such speed? So what was built into the organization from before that others, new organizations can learn?
I think the trust. Trust again, and the desire. Both these. Like, our colleagues were really desirous of doing things and supporting the community, the migrant. I saw one picture when my colleague is stand. Many of our colleagues would themselves cook for the migrant workers who are returning to Ranchi station and all. With their own cars, they will go and start distributing food. The community which were not able to sell their watermelons, they will go and distribute watermelons to these returning migrants. So the desire to do for other, that is what was increasing the speed. So we were ourselves surprised. We had thought that our work will reduce, but the outreach was more, as well as the COVID thing was so much more. So I think that desire, the trust that people, if they think that it is difficult to go, they will decide. If they think they can manage, they will decide. So going with them is very important.
Perfect. Last question for you. How the need for funder sensitivity has been mentioned. How do we continue going on a path of continued flexibility and continued trust?
Yeah. I want to take the opportunity to actually highlight a very interesting fund being launched. It's called the Grow Fund. Do check it out. It's by a collaborative effort of multiple funders. There's Rohini Nilekani Philanthropies, A.T. Chandra Foundation, Edel Give, and a few other funders that are together. And I think many funders have seen that nonprofits have not had corpuses, they've not had enough budgets to really hire second line leadership. And a lot of the founders have sort of been exhausted and burnt out. And there's sort of a gap, right? Or even if it's, whether it's systems, processes, websites, marketing and stuff, they've never really been budget line items. Parul said a really important point, right? Like, walk the talk, right? It's easy to sort of say mental health is important, right? And not allocate budget to it, right? Acumen has been guilty of asking service providers to provide services for our fellows organizations and our fellows and not sort of put money to it, right? So we're like, hey, our fellows need mental health services. Please give us pro bono hours, right? And then we're like, wait, what? Like, who's going to pay for mental health, right? Everyone needs it, but like, we don't have enough mental health providers, right? And then who's going to take care of the caregivers eventually, right? But it's changing, right? And I think we've got to keep the conversation going, right? There are funds that are opening up that are going to be thinking beyond project-based funding or programmatic funding, but really investing in capacity building. I think it's a 10 million fund, and there's more coming up as well. So check it out. It's really cool. Yeah. I'll stop there.
This is very helpful. We're almost at time. So I feel like the last answer that covered everything. Smitaji said, build organizations in trust. Parul said, rethink success. Neeraj said, build organizations in flexibility. And Abbas said, put money where your mouth is. So I feel like that perfectly summarizes our entire conversation. Thanks, everybody, for all the questions. Thank you to the panelists for all your time, insight, and absolute honesty with difficulties as well as what we've learned. And thanks, Nudge, Manoj, and Thoral for organizing and putting this together. Thanks, everybody.
This was a great, very well spent afternoon. Thank you so much, everyone.
Yeah, it was really, really nice.
Thanks, Medha and Thoral, for putting the session together. I really think it was a much needed session. Neeraj, Abbas, Parul, and Smita, thank you so much for the wisdom and sharing your experience. Thank you, audience, for the participation. Quick announcement, we have other interesting sessions happening post this and tomorrow till about 1 p.m. So request you to please look around the platform, go check, sessions of your interest, and please participate. That's all from this session, I guess. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. Take care. Bye-bye.